Well, our psalm today begins with this jubilant exaltation of God's goodness and God's love. We are called to give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. It's a fabulous call for us. It's a fabulous reminder of God's goodness and love. And it's not an unfamiliar call. You know, that phrase that begins the psalm is repeated in several psalms throughout our scriptures. Often we talk about the goodness of God for us. We have poems, we have hymns, we have illustrations aimed at bringing this truth into our lives. So too with the unfailing and enduring love. Spend even a fraction of time in church, and you should hear the message that God loves you, that God redeems you, and that God desires to gather you into eternal life. But sometimes we do a disservice when we make it sound like that's the end of the road. There's no more for us. We make it sound like as long as we hear the good news of God's love and redemption, we have fulfilled each and every spiritual requirement. That there's nothing else that we need to focus on. What about when, even in light of God's goodness and God's love, we choose to disregard it? What happens when, even in the midst of this wonderful proclamation, we decide that the goodness of God and the love and the presence of God, while sounding really, really great, doesn't really have anything to do with how we live our lives? What then? That's the situation a little bit that our psalm talks about. Psalm 107 is a very interesting psalm, and I encourage you at some point to go home and to read it because it has several repeated phrases that occur over and over again. This psalm is built on the description of people who, for whatever reason, turn their backs on the grand goodness and love declared in the first three verses. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. It talks about the redemption. That's the beginning part, which is kind of like a call which extends over all areas of life. But then the psalm goes on and talks about, in verse 17 that we heard, well, some became fools because of their rebellious ways. Some did this, some did that. Now, the language of fool or being foolish is quite constant in Scripture. We hear it in several of the Psalms. Psalm 14, for instance, the fool says in their heart, there is no God. Jesus himself tells a story about a rich man gathering all his possessions into bigger and bigger barns and then saying to himself, well, that's it. Everything's done. I can just eat, drink, and be merry because this is what life is all about. It's a parable which is affectionately called the parable of the rich fool, because that's the word that Jesus uses to describe him. You fool. Now, when we hear that term, fool, we hear it as a dismissal of intelligence. We associate being foolish or being a fool with acting in a way which betrays all intellectual ability. I actually went to the dictionary and I looked up this term, and it listed a whole bunch, after the definition, a whole bunch of synonyms. Blockhead, idiot, dunce, ignoramus, cretin, halfwit, my personal favorite, schmuck, right? So anybody would be rightly insulted to be called a fool. In Scripture, however, that's not what this word means. The word in Hebrew is nabal, and it doesn't refer to the lack of intelligence. It refers to somebody who willfully rejects the presence of God. It is more about a moral and a spiritual rejection than an intellectual one. It is one who touts their own independence and says, I can do things my way. So verse 17 speaks about people who willfully reject the goodness and the love of God, God's presence, and God's guidance. They rebel against God and decide to do things their own way. their own thing. Well, what happens? They suffer affliction because of their iniquities. This is one of the hard lessons of Scripture, and it is one that we sit uncomfortably with in Lent. When we decide to turn our backs on God, on God's love, on God's mercy for us, we are telling God that we can handle our spiritual lives by ourselves. We can work out our own forgiveness. We can deal with our own emotional and our own spiritual baggages and burdens. We don't need any help. A few years back, I think I told a story about how my brother and I, when we were about 7 or 8 respectively, decided to run away from home. And so we gathered up that which was necessary for our journey into our own personal freedom. I took my large, heavy, yellow Tonka truck. That's what I took. If you remember the story, you may also remember that my father began to follow us as we ran away, which was not very nice for us. You can't run away when your dad's right behind you. But anyway. But here's the important part. As much as I began this rebellion thinking, you know, I can carry this truck myself, very quickly it became abundantly clear that I couldn't. It began to weigh on me. My arms began to burn, and what began as a journey of self-empowerment began as exercise in weakness. We hear that constantly in Scripture. It talks about rebellion in our psalm, those who were in rebellion drawing near to the gates of death. Our life gets strained. In another psalm, Psalm number 30, it talks about when I was silent, when I turned away from God, I felt as if my bones wasted away. And my strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. We just can't do it ourselves. But in rebellion, we think we can. So while I was running away with my big yellow Tonka truck, I tried to do everything I could to minimize the weight. I moved it around. I shifted it from one arm to the other. I tried handing it to my brother. That didn't work. I tried handing it to my father, but he refused to take it because I was running away from him. Because that's the thing about rebellion, isn't it? See, the issue isn't that God isn't with us. After all, he is good and his love endures forever. God is with us no matter what. For Israel, in the state of foolish self-mastery and pride, God was still always with them. The problem was they weren't with God. They were trying to run away. And so that spiritual baggage, that weight that is produced through their own mistakes and through their own sins and their own faults, it just sits there, and it lingers, and it festers. That is, until we reach verse 19. Then they cried to the Lord in their distress. See, this psalm isn't about a hard look at what rebellion and sin does to our spiritual life. This psalm is actually about the wonderful gift of healing that comes into our life when we acknowledge our need for God. Christian author Dallas Willard used to always say that I can give you an address for God. It is at the end of your rope. Here in this psalm, in Scripture, we uncover that awful, that sometimes unbearable, but ultimately that liberating truth that we cannot save ourselves. It's brilliantly depicted in our reading from Numbers. Now the Israelites, powerless against the results of their own waywardness, and they have to cry out to God for their salvation. They must again turn their gaze. They have to turn their lives toward the healing presence of God, which is illustrated through the snake on the pole. And so Jesus says, in the same way, the Son of Man will be lifted up so that we can turn to him, cast our eyes, our hearts, our lives unto him, and be healed. Verse 20 of our psalm says that God sends forth his word and heals them. He rescues them from the grave. Those who were so close to the gates of death are now ushered into life. And out of that liberation, again and again and again, which is constantly open and available to us, we are called to give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love, to live out songs of joy, to give our thanks. Because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive in Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. Because it is by grace we are saved, not from ourselves. It is the gift of God. This psalm, it's interesting because the scenario that we have from verse 17 to verse 22 is actually repeated four times. One of the things that you hear repeated over is some did this, some did that, some did this, some did that. Some wandered in a desert wasteland, finding no way that they could settle. Some sat in darkness and deepest gloom, prisoners suffering in iron chains. Some became fools through rebellious ways and suffered affliction because of their iniquity. Some went out to sea where they were in peril and at their wits' end. Is there one of those situations, which even just a little bit, describes you this morning? Do you find yourself wandering and spiritually restless, longing for a completeness that you just can't find? Are you sitting in darkness? Is there a hopelessness, a despair that you are struggling with? Have you decided to do your own thing, and now you're finding out that it isn't turning out the way that you would have liked? Have you come to the end of your rope and are now at your wit's end and are finding yourself lost and helpless? In our psalm, verse 6, verse 13, verse 19, and verse 28 all declare the solution. And they declare the solution in the exact same words. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. Jesus also declares the solution. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, so that whoever, wherever, whenever, believe in him will not perish, but have eternal life. See, God doesn't want to usher us into a doctrinal understanding of his love and goodness. God wants us to experience it, to live within it. All the statements about God's unyielding and everlasting love for us is for the purpose of our immersion in it. God wants us to be flooded with his goodness, mercy, forgiveness, and love. Our life is to be lived with God this moment. And it is for life here and now that Jesus stands to be looked on as the way to usher us into that healing, into that joy, into that life. And so even for you, in the smallest of capacities, even if there is just one area of life where you might resonate with one of those four categories of what we might call lostness. Some did this, some did that, some did this. But part of you resonates with that. Then I invite you to do that call, to turn your eyes to the Lord. Please pray with me. Almighty God, in this season of Lent, we rest with the uncomfortable truth that we cannot save ourselves. And we look to and look at the areas of our lives where maybe we have turned away from you, or we've sat in darkness, or maybe we're feeling lost and at the end of our rope. And so we turn to you and we cry out to you. Ask you, O Lord, to come into our heart and our lives and to bring that healing presence that only you can bring through your grace and your love for us. Amen.